So we've been talking about God and just how he is so amazing. And we use the word awesome, but awesome is really God. God is truly the most amazing. He's the one worthy of our praise. So the title of today's lesson is Stand in Awe of His Glory, Honor, and Power. Stand in Awe of His Glory, Honor, and Power. So I don't know if you, y'all, have ever met your favorite celebrity.
No.
So imagine if you were sitting at the table with them. It's like, how are you going to have dinner with them? It's like, what would you ask them? Or would you be awestruck? You do not have the words to say.
Yeah.
Right? Would you be there like, how did you think of this song? It's like, you don't even know where to start, right?
Yeah.
Like, this is the person I've listened to their music, I've seen their design, whatever it may be. It's like, wow, this athlete I've watched dunk or, you know, whatever. It's like, wow, this guy's amazing. This person's amazing. Just think about how amazing it would be to meet that person, right? Then when I think, like, I've never had that opportunity, so I don't know what I would say. But when you think about it, it's like, wow, God being the creator.
Yeah.
Who even created those people, right? Wow. Created those ideas, created those concepts, created us. Am I in awe of that God? You know, does that God amaze me in that same way? It's like, wow, that is something to think about, being awestruck by God. Let's go to Revelation chapter 4.
Come on, Cam.
And look at an example of being awestruck by God. Revelation chapter 4, verse 9.
Okay.
Revelation chapter 4, verse 9. It's amazing because I think this is the cheat code to life.
Okay,
right?
Cheat code.
We like cheat codes. We like the easy way, the straight path.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know if anybody's ever played Grand Theft Auto.
There's a lot of cheat codes in that game.
It's like, how do I get unlimited ammo? Right?
Yeah.
How do I just jump straight to the end? Like, what's that an easy way? Right? I think these scriptures, when we think about God's glory, honor, and power, we can see the cheat code to life. In Revelation 4, verse 9, it says, whenever the living creature gives glory, honor, and thanks to him who sits on the throne, and who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him who sits on the throne and worship him who lives forever and ever. They lay their crowns before the throne and say, you are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power. Wow. The elders fall down and worship. It says they do that when the living creatures honor God on the throne. Right? In verse 9 says, whenever the living creatures give glory and honor, that's when the elders will fall down and worship as well. In verse 8, we see that each of the four living creatures, it says, had six wings and was covered with eyes all around, even under its wings. Day and night, they never stopped saying, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Right? In verse 9, it says, whenever the living creatures do this, the elders also worship. In verse 8, it says, that is continually. So this is a continuous process.
Yeah.
It never stops.
Yeah.
The elders continue to worship when the living creatures worship. The living creatures never stop worshiping. So that means the elders, they're never stopping worshiping God.
Wow.
Because they are awestruck by how amazing He is. Because God is worthy of our glory, honor, and praise. Let's go to Revelation chapter 5.
Ooh.
Verse 11. It's just amazing to see how in awe you can be of God.
Yeah.
And when I think of it and I read these scriptures, I'm like, wow. I'm at like a level 1. You know, like -1 on that scale. It's like when I think about how these elders, how these living creatures are so in awe of God.
Yeah.
I'm like, I am way far behind.
Yeah.
Right? In Revelation 5, verse 11, we see another example. It says, then I looked and heard the voice of many angels, numbering thousands upon thousands, and 10,000 times 10,000. They encircled the throne and living creatures and the elders. So we see those same people there, living creatures and elders. In a loud voice, they were saying, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and glory,
wow,
and honor and praise.
Wow.
Worthy. Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and on the sea and all that is in them saying, to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever,
wow,
and ever.
Yeah.
The four living creatures said, amen, and the elders fell down and worshiped. Right? We see here that continuous falling down.
Mm-hmm.
Right? The image that pops in my head, I would see, like, I remember my parents watching, like, the old Michael Jackson concerts. Right?
Yeah.
And then somebody touched Michael Jackson, and they just fall out. Like, you know, like,
yeah,
it's like, what's going on here? But here we see just the elders knowing what true worship looks like.
Yeah.
Like that is true worship. Just mm-hmm. knowing who you're in contact with.
Mm-hmm.
Knowing their power. Knowing that they are worthy of continuous worship. It's just amazing to see that. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3.
Come on, Cameron.
Hopefully this gives you a good perspective,
yeah,
of what it means to be in awe of God.
Yeah.
Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3. It's amazing just to see these verses.
Thank you.
In verse 3 it says, the Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. Jesus is the radiance of God's word.
Mm-hmm.
Radiating through the scriptures about all that God can do.
Yeah.
His glory in the flesh. And we get to read the scriptures about how amazing Jesus was.
Mm-hmm.
And in John it says, they didn't even capture all of his miracles.
Wow.
Because it was too much. Right? There was too much to write down.
Yeah.
And we think about the glory of God. It is too much to even fit in the scriptures. It is too much to even capture in our minds. It's like, well, I've been on negative one, right? Of what it means of knowing about giving God glory. So the first point is stand in awe of his glory.
Wow.
Stand in awe of his glory. So let's go to Romans chapter 3.
Thank you.
Romans chapter 3. It's amazing to see in the scriptures how we compare to God's glory, to God's honor, to God's power. So in Romans 3, verse 23, it gives me a very sober look at how I compare to God's glory. In Romans 3, 23, says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Right? It's like, man. Me as a person cannot even fathom, right, God's glory, because I've always fallen short, right? But it's amazing.
Yeah.
We know that, and we saw in the video, the Easter, right, the Easter reminder that Jesus came and sacrificed for us to bridge that gap, right? Because none of us reaching for God in that, we can't even touch his glory,
yeah,
because we have been separated. And let's go to Psalms 27, verse 19. Oh, this isn't too many scriptures.
No, it's great. Right.
Psalms 27, verse 19. Psalms 27, verse 19.
Amen.
In this scripture, that's not the right one. You got it, bro. Well, the scripture is in Psalms.
Yes.
One of the chapters.
You got
talks
it.
About the earth being filled with his glory.
Mm.
And it's just amazing. If somebody Googles it and finds it,
we got it.
We're going to go to the next one in Habakkuk chapter 2. About, again, just the earth being filled with God's glory. Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 14, it says, for the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord, as the waters cover the sea. And when I was reading this scripture, I was like, I don't even know what the waters covering the sea even means.
Yeah.
Right? It's like, I can't even understand how glorious God is. It's like, God is so glorious that it is filled amongst the earth. Every nature miracle that we see is a reminder of God's glory. It's a reminder of how glorious God is. Every natural disaster, it's like, wow, God's glory, God's power is unfathomable, right? Like, it is so amazing just how glorious God is. And so when we come before God, right, we think about just this being that is enough to fill every void, right?
Yeah.
Fill the darkness with light.
Yeah.
To do such amazing things, to bring so much glory. And it's amazing to think that us compared to that amazing God,
yeah,
right? We get to have an encounter with that God. He is a creator that wants to be in touch with us, even in his glorious majesty. And when I think about how we think about people on earth that have impact on people, awe-inducing impact, and how they separate themselves from people.
Yeah.
But God being the exact opposite, who wants that relationship with us. He's so powerful.
Yeah.
He is. But yet he still wants to invite us in. He still wants to have dinner with us at his table.
Come on.
Right? He still wants that relationship with us. Let's go to the second point. Stand in awe of his honor.
Come on, man.
Stand in awe of his honor. You got this? 57:11.
Or 72:19.
Yeah. Oh, it's probably 72:19.
Yeah, you reversed it.
That's actually what I have written here, 17:19. Yes. I just said 27. There you go. 72:19. Psalm 72:19 is that scripture. May the earth be filled with his glory. Thank you. Thank you, Heidi, as well. So, second point, stand in awe of his honor. Honor is having high respect. And so it's us understanding that God's name, his word, are high respect.
Yeah.
God being a being that's word, high respect. Right? And what do you do when you respect someone? Right? Like, how do you approach someone that you have respect for? Let's look at a few scriptures. Go to 1 Timothy chapter 1.
Come on, Cam.
Verse 17. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 17. And it says, "Now to the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever." Amen.
Amen.
The only God that deserves honor. He's the only God, the only thing in our life that truly deserves that high respect. Because God is perfect.
Yeah.
God being our creator is perfect. And he created every one of us.
Yeah.
In his image.
Yeah.
God being a God that deserves that honor. In Proverbs chapter 3, verse 9, it tells us about honoring God. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 9. And it tells us how we can honor God.
Mm-hmm.
Right? It's hard to think. Someone says, "Hey, honor God." It's like, what does that mean? What does that look like? How do we do that? In Proverbs chapter 3, verse 9, it says, "Honor the Lord." It says, "I will question you, and you shall answer me." So one day I can tell you don't know anything, and then somebody's going to ask me questions, and you can answer. Good luck. All right. And then verse 4 says, "Where were you when I laid the earth's foundation?"
Wow.
What?
Yeah.
Not there. And then it says, "Tell me if you understand. Who marked off his dimensions? Surely you know."
Wow.
And if you're sarcastic, that's how you know you're made in God's image. Who my God is mentioned? Surely you know. It's like, I'm sure you know, Joe. Who stretched the measured line across it? On what were its footing set? And who laid its cornerstone? While the morning stars sang together, and all the angels shouted for joy. This passage is just amazing display of God's power.
Yeah.
If you read more of Job, you'll just continue to see it. Right?
Yeah.
It talks about the animals. It talks about just so many different aspects of nature that we have no idea why they happen the way they do. But in this scripture, it just shows that God is so powerful.
Yeah.
And then, so let's fast forward. Let's see Job's response in verse 40, in chapter 40.
Yeah.
Come on, Cam.
Joseph's Apostle, chapter 4, verse 1. So we'll see again the ending of what God is saying to Job. Says, the Lord said to Job, will the one who contends with the Almighty correct him? Let him who accuses God answer him. Right? So here we come to the part, it's like, Job, all right, what's your answer? Mm-hmm. In verse 3, it says, then Job answered the Lord. I don't even know how Job spoke. Verse 4 says, I am unworthy. How can I reply to you? I put my hand over my mouth. I spoke once, but I have no answer. Twice, I will say no more. Wow. You keep reading?
Yeah.
Come on, Cam.
God's like, I'm going to go.
Yeah.
So verse 17 says again, brace yourself like a man. And he keeps going because God is showing Job, he's showing us that God is a God of power.
Yeah.
He is a God that understands, that knows, that his thoughts are higher than our thoughts, that his power is supreme, that he is able to do anything.
Yeah.
And we can't fathom it. We can't understand it. And it is just so amazing that often we need to be reminded by God.
Mm-hmm.
We have to be humble before we truly understand his power.
Wow.
Right? And it's always a time of do we choose to humble ourselves? But does it require God coming out of a storm to humble us? Right? Does it take us being in a valley, a dark valley, before we truly recognize God's power? Before we truly recognize that God is worth our respect? Before we truly recognize that God is the one that we should honor? Or can we take the scriptures, can we take Job's experience and apply it to our lives? Just in closing, how do we respond to a God that is so great, that is so worthy of glory, so worthy of honor, so worthy because of his power? Right? In Luke 15:21, we see in Luke 15 the story of the son that returned back to his father, right, the prodigal son. In Luke 15:21, it says, the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Right? When I just study out God's scriptures, when I just think about all the ways that I have fallen short, it gives me that true heart. It's like, I'm not even worthy of your love.
Yeah.
But God, you are so amazing. Because you're a God that allows me that opportunity to be in a relationship with you. Last scripture we'll look at is in Ephesians chapter 4.
Come on, Cam.
Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1. Hope has been helpful.
Yeah.
To understand.
Come on, bro. It's super awesome.
God. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1. And this scripture tells us what it looks like to live a life for. Paul breaks it down for us. And it says in verse 1, Ephesians chapter 4, as a prisoner for the Lord, then I urge you to live a life worthy of the call you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient. Bear with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There's one God, or there's one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all. Goes over all and through all and in all. Living a life that's pleasing to God, that's honorable to God, comes from His Word.
Yeah.
It comes from learning what it means through God's eyes to live a life that's worthy of Him. Right? In this scripture, it gives us just a few examples. Being humble, being gentle, being patient, bear with one another in love, right? You may not know if you're doing these things, but other people know if you're not.
Right? Yeah.
So it's a great time to allow others to help you, right? It's like, hey, am I patient? Or am I impatient? Right? Am I approaching others in love? Am I doing these things? Right? And so as we think about just standing in awe of His glory, honor, and power, I just hope we can continue to focus just how God is so much greater than anything we may be going through. And I love you all so much.
Yeah.